அமைச்சர் திரு வேலுமணி அவர்களே, நாச்சிமுத்து குழுமத்தின் தலைவர் டாக்டர் மாணிக்கம் அவர்களே, பாரதிய வித்யாபவன் தலைவர் டாக்டர் பி கே கிருஷ்ணராஜ் அவர்களே, மனவராயர் அவர்களே, நாச்சிமுத்து குழும நிறுவனத்தின் செயலாளர் டாக்டர் சி ராமசுவாமி அவர்களே, நாச்சிமுத்து குழுமத்தின் துணைத் தலைவர் எம் பாலசுப்ரமணியம் அவர்களே, முன்னாள் முனைவர் சங்கத்தின் தலைவர் கே பாலசுப்ரமணியன் அவர்களே, நிருபர் ஸ்ரீ ஹரிஹரன் சுதான் அவர்களே, குமரகுரு தொழில்நுட்ப கல்லூரியின் இணை பதிவாளர் ஸ்ரீ சங்கர் அவர்களே, சகோதர சகோதரங்களே, அனைவருக்கும் வணக்கம். திரு சி பி ராதாகிருஷ்ணன் ஆல்சோ இஸ் ஹியர். இன்றைய நிகழ்ச்சிக்கு வந்திருக்கும் அனைத்து தமிழர் குழந்தைகளுக்கும் வணக்கம். தமிழும் தமிழ்நாடும் என் மதிர்க்கு நெருக்கமானவை. நாச்சிமுத்து கலகி நிறுவனங்களின் உயரவிழா கொண்டாட்டத்தில் கலந்து கொள்வதில் நானும் பெருமகிழ்ச்சி அடைகிறேன். இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியில் உங்களுடன் உரையாடுவதில் நானும் பெருமகிழ்ச்சி அடைகிறேன். தமிழும் தெரியும், பேச முடியாது, தயவுட்டு மன்னிக்கும். ஐ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் தமிழ், பட் ஐ கேனாட் ஸ்பீக் எஃபெக்டிவ்லி. தட்ஸ் வை ஐ நெவர் ட்ரை டு டூ தட் எக்ஸ்பெரிமெண்ட், பிகாஸ் எ பர்சன் ஹூ இஸ் ஃப்ளூயன்ட் இன் ஒன் லாங்குவேஜ், if he is not fluent in other language and trying to speak in that language is no good. And after hearing such a beautiful Tamil speech by the chairman of the Bharati Vidya Bhavan, a wonderful personality coming out of this region, I don't want to make an experiment. Friends, I am really delighted to be here with you today at the valedictory function of the Diamond Jubilee celebration of Nachimuthu Industrial Association. It is also a pleasure to be admitting young students who would be the builders of new India, a resurgent India, a represent India, and an India that is sum total of billion dreams, an India that has the ability to nurture and fulfill a billion dreams. Friends, it's a pleasure to reconnect that I was here in this campus in the month of August 2003 to inaugurate the Alumni Center on the occasion of the centenary celebrations of the founder, Sri P. Nachimuthu Gowndar. Sri P. Nachimuthu Gowndar, founder of Anamalaya's Bus Transport Company, father of Arutchelvar, Dr. N. Mahalingam, and a great embodiment of hard work and perseverance, had a vision to start a technical education institution in Polachi. People wonder why I have special interest in Polachi. Because I was so much influenced, inspired by the life of Arutchelvar Dr. Mahalingam. Every aspect of his life, let me be very frank. Now I am not in politics also, and I do not belong to any party, either CP Radhakrishnan party or Vanathi's party or Velumarai's party. I am a no party man, practically an all party man, retired from politics but not tired from public life. That's why I am here. I must tell you, Dr. Mahalingam is an ideal person, ideal in every sense. And if you go through his life, I suggest to all the students and also people of the region to go through his life biography, understand each and every moment, how he has molded himself, conducted himself for the cause of the people, for the cause of this region, without compromise on his basic principles, how he got elected as MLA, how he could face such stalwarts at the time and work with them, Subramanyamji, Kamaraj Nadar, Rajagopalachari, all great stalwarts. He had worked with all of them, and being in thick of politics and coming out of politics is not an easy thing. There are people who are in politics who don't want to leave the chair till they are thrown out or they are no more, either way. We are seeing it also. But here is a person, at the height of his popularity, he left politics. And then he took public cause and established all these institutions in memory of his father and developed such an ideal campus and then set an example for the entire country. I suggest that the people from other regions should also come here to Palachi, see the institutions he has set up, including this polytechnic. This is an ideal polytechnic, I would say. I have seen a lot of polytechnics. Some of them government politics, and some of them are sleeping, some are weeping. We are all aware of it. So if how to revitalize polytechnics, this is a great example. And also school, new experiment, 3 days study, 3 days work. Learn and earn together. That's the model he has put before the nation. And today, these technical education institutions in Palachi, they're a role model for other regions of the country. He strongly believed that it would benefit the youth of this countryside, which has a predominantly agrarian population. India is mostly rural. Though urbanization has become a reality, we are all seeing now because of education, employment, entertainment, enhancement of economic activity and enhanced medical facilities, people are moving from rural area to urban areas. Even I have moved from rural development ministry to urban development ministry. I was minister for rural development during Vajpayee's period when I came here. And subsequently in Narendra Bhai's government, I became urban development minister. I asked my friends, "Bhai, what is this? My heart is with the rural people." They said, "Rural people are coming to urban areas, you have to take care of them, that's the reason." Whatever it is. Gandhiji, after independence, gave two advice to all leaders. One advice is political. I don't want to dwell on that because it will be misunderstood. He said, disband the Congress. Because Congress was a platform to fight for independence, not a party. Purpose is over, you disband. Okay. Second was, he said, go back to villages, move back to villages. But unfortunately, our leaders have shown their back to villages and moved to towns. With the result, there is an urban-rural divide now in the country. This is one challenge before the nation. We have to bridge this urban-rural divide. There are other challenges like poverty. 20% of the people are poor even today. There are other challenges like illiteracy. 22% of the people cannot write and read. There is a problem of even today gender discrimination in certain areas. There is a lot of improvement, but still there is some gender discrimination. And also there is untouchability in certain areas, which is a shame and challenge. And the youth must take up that challenge and see to it that this atrocious practice of discriminating people on the basis of a religion or caste is done away with at the earliest. That should be really the task for the younger generation, and we need to be progressive. And we have to be aggressive in campaigning and championing this particular thought. The rural areas, they produce food for all of us. We have to take care of rural empowerment is the need of the hour. And that's why I suggested the other day, and my book was released by the Prime Minister and the former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, and so Devagoudaji and Finance Minister. I told the Finance Minister, there is a need to have a rural bias. Rural bias. I intentionally use that word, like you give reservation to scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, some upliftment because they have been historically denied their rightful place. Rightly they are given. But same thing has to, I am not talking of reservation, but reservation in allocation of funds, plans, programs, institutions, rural areas must be given importance. My respect for Mahalingam has gone up because he did not think of starting all these institutions in Chennai. That would have been more, profitable. But he never thought of profit. He wanted to develop rural area and his own area. Yes, he did a good thing. He did a good thing. Normally, you know, leaders, they always try to reach the capital, to make capital. But here is a person who has shown to the country and set the models of Gandhian values by his commitment to the cause of the uplift of the rural people. India is a huge country, my friends. We may all think, no, what is there, agriculture and all. We need food now. Everybody requires food. We have surplus food thanks to revolution and green revolution and also efforts made by C. Subramaniam ji, efforts made by our Swaminathan and so many great scientists and out of all and above all the great farmers of this country, they are producing surplus food. But you cannot be relaxed because we are having a growing population and there is also a problem of a hidden hunger. You don't know, you are still hungry in spite of having all this. There may be nutritional deficiency in some of us. You go to doctor, you tell you D3 deficiency, B12 deficiency, this vitamin deficiency, that vitamin, because we are not eating proper food. One is junk food for the youngsters, other one is plain white, totally polished rice. We are not eating our age-old, rich protein food. Ragi, bajra, jowar, other cereals and all, we are neglecting them. I'll come to it a little later. A country like India cannot sustain on imported food security. You need to have homegrown food security. So that's why agriculture, which is our basic culture, should be preserved. Extended support need to be given. I am happy the Prime Minister of India, Narendra Bhai Modi, and various state governments, they are focusing their attention on agriculture. But much more needed to be done. Much more needed to be done because people are leaving agriculture, moving to urban areas. You ask any doctor, he want to make his son his doctor. You want any actor, you want his son to be made into an actor, even the face is not good. You ask a teacher, he will say you want to make his son as a teacher. You ask an industrialist, he want to promote his son as an industrialist, businessman. Any profession, naturally. Ask a doctor or actor, but you ask a tractor running farmer, he will say, no, I don't want my son to do this. Because agriculture is becoming unremunerative, troublesome, the vagaries of monsoon, the tricks of the trade, the marketing conditions, weather conditions, all these things are not favorable to the agriculture community. So you need to give special importance to agriculture. We are happy. With that foresight, Mahalingam ji started an agriculture institute. Agriculture institute starting here. He started here. This is really inspiring to others. Friends, we have to adhere to the core values which Mahalingam ji has adhered to. The values of equity, transparency, creativity, teamwork, environmental sustainability, staff development and women participation. In all these spheres of activity, this institution and this family, I have no hesitation to say, they have done a wonderful work worthy among them. To mark the celebration of 4 decades of service and the 75th birth anniversary of Achyutarwar in 1998, a self-financing engineering college in the name of Dr. Mahalingam was established. Dr. Mahalingam College of Engineering and Technology, MCET, is also celebrating its 2 decades of service this year. There are truly exciting times for India. There are quite a few reasons to justify this statement. One is that India today stands at the cusp of tremendous demographic opportunity. India is relatively a young nation. More than 65% of the population is below 35. More than 50% of the population is below 50. Below 25. The average age of India will be expected to be 29 years, while it will be 37 for China, 48 for Japan. So we are an young nation, full of youthful energy, enthusiasm, brimming with creative zeal. The government has initiated schemes like Skill India, Digital India, Startup India, Stand Up India, Mudra Bank, to tap this huge demographic potential by channelizing the energies of the youth in the right direction, empowering them. New vocabulary has been added, new idioms. Make in India, Skill India, Digital India, Green India, MCDC program. Swachh Bharat, Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, Beti Padao, for drop and crop, all new ideas, Digital India, 2,50,000 villages are being connected through optic fiber line, massive transformation is going on, and then slowly online, everything has to be online, apply online, get the reply online, otherwise deemed to have been given reply, permission. No line at all in future, no line. That should be the line for all people to come. Standing in a line, waiting for some time and all, these things should not happen. That is the vision of the Prime Minister and the government and the people. So we must work in that direction. And also directly transferring the benefits to the people. No need to go to office, around tahsil office, mandal office, block development office, register office, number of times going around, meeting people, greeting people, shaking hands with people, doing something in between hands. There should not be any need for the same. That should be the future of India. That's what the rulers are planning. We must all join that campaign, campaign against corruption, campaign against black money, campaign against evasion of taxes, campaign against encroachments. Encroachment is a big menace for all of us. For the urban development, we are seeing all the cities. We are talking of smart cities. Smart cities is possible only if the people are smart, if the leaders are smart. Not smart in the sense of height, weight, coat, boot, suit, hat. Smart in vision, smart in thinking, smart in execution. You need smart leaders, smart vision for them. So, my friends, what I am trying to say is, these young people like you, to make use of this opportunity, focus on building knowledge that is both deep and wide in your subject. My dear young friends, I cannot stress enough on the need to continuously learn, continuously upgrade your skills so that they stay relevant to the times. We are living in an era of LPG, liberalization, privatization, globalization. The entire world is moving faster. You cannot lag behind. What is happening in Porachi is known in Pune in few minutes. What is happening in Pune will be known in San Francisco in few minutes. That is the situation. So you must learn what is happening outside, what are the challenges, what are the opportunities, and equip yourself with those opportunities, with these learning methods. You must go on learning. Even the teachers have to be trained continuously to upgrade their skills. That's why skill development is an important component of the education system now. The Prime Minister started education, a ministry for skill development. There are abundant skills in our country, among every section of the people. Irrespective of caste, creed, sex, religion and region, every Indian has got some skill or other. The taddy tapper, the weaver, the fisherman, the goldsmith, the blacksmith, the dhobi, or the food maker, everyone has got some talent. And it's time-tested talent. What is required is upgrading the skills. Dr. Mahalingam thought about it. That's why upgrading of the skills and new ideas through your polytechnic, through your engineering colleges, these skills are being upgraded. And take that opportunity, take that advantage, and try to excel. This land is very fertile. India land is fertile. Coimbatore, Polachi land is more fertile. Land is fertile, brains are also fertile. You look at the country, world today, you go to Silicon Valley, every second person in the IT sector will be from India. And out of every second person, the next second person will be from South. Because talent is here. You have IT companies, chief from India. Indira Nui, Sundar Pichai, Satya Nadella, Sagurti Purna. Yesterday gave some Geeta Govindam to the International Monetary Fund economist. Geeta Gopina, sorry. What is happening? What is happening? That means a lot of energy and skills are there. We need to upgrade. We need to Geeta Govindam with the picture. That's why boys are laughing. I know that. Just some 10 days back, I saw that movie. It had some influence on my mind. But we are lagging in skill upgradation. This is a big challenge. We have only 4.69% of the total workforce in India which has undergone a formal skill training, as compared to 68% in UK, 75% in Germany, 25% in USA, and 52% in USA, and 80% in Japan, and 96% in South Korea. South Korea is a small nation. See, you have TV, you have fridge, you have all from South Korea. And we are such a huge nation. We can develop skills, we can upgrade skills. So it's a challenge. And this challenge has to be met by all, not by one government alone. There are few reasons why I say this is the best times for India. We in India are committed to building a $5 trillion economy by 2025, making India the third largest consumer market in the world. India has claimed 30 place in the World Bank ease of doing business. This year, the International Monetary Fund yesterday forecasted India will grow at more than 7% in 2018 and 19 ahead of other major economies including China. This is what the International Monetary Fund is saying. We have to work together. Center and state must work as Team India. As I mentioned earlier, so many policy initiatives are taken up by the Government of India. We have a strong global confidence in Indian growth story and a surge in foreign direct investment which reached US billion 62 in 2017-18. My dear friends, I have been to recently Guatemala, Panama, Peru, and I have been to Serbia, Malta, and also Romania. Everywhere there is tremendous interest about India. People are very much happy about the growth story of India. The entire world is looking towards India. And it's a great opportunity for all of us to grab the opportunity and then take the country forward. The development of any country depends greatly upon the quality of its engineers, its builders, its architects. I came across a very disturbing report by a leading employment solution company that claimed more than 90% of Indian graduates are unemployable. The same issue was flagged by almost a decade ago. NASSCOM estimates that 6 million people are required in cyber security sector alone by 2022. But we have a tremendous skill gap in engineering. We have to revisit our syllabus of engineering colleges. Make it more employable. Make it more employable. 4 years of study, getting a degree, and then being an unemployed youth is no good. We have to fill this gap. And I request the teachers to take a good hard look at the curricula and teaching methods, not only in engineering college but also in other education institutions. The focus should be on continuously honing and polishing skills and learning by constant practices. It is sad to note that India, in spite of having one of the best talent pools and one of the strongest human resource base of the world, is unable to keep up with the kind of scientific breakthrough that are happening in the Western world. I was pursuing an article on the recently decorated Nobel Prize winners of 2018. The winner of the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2018 has made a discovery that will have to be termed as miraculous. Arthur Ashkin has invented optical tweezers that grab particles, atoms, viruses and other living cells with their laser beam fingers. In layman's terms, this new tool would allow us to move some objects using nothing but laser light. Imagine moving objects using just light. The invention would bring about paradigm shift in a number of scientific and technological arenas. Practical application include but are not limited by removing bacteria without harming the surrounding healthy cells. The world is now struggling to distinguish the boundaries between science and science fiction. Anything seems possible new through science and technology. India should be at the forefront of pushing boundaries of knowledge and challenging dogmas. We have always been the Vishwa Guru, the wise teacher to the world, or a Margadarshi for excellence. It is time we reclaim the status which is rightfully ours, and you, my dear young students, will drive the innovation machine that will take us there. Innovation, innovation. That should be the buzzword for all of us. Coming out with new ideas. Just now, I have inaugurated a hospital. It has cancer without the need to go for chemotherapy. By simple methods, by pumping oxygen. This is really miraculous. Really magic. Such technologies, such innovations has to be developed and promoted and propagated across the country. That is the need of the hour. I'm very happy that in a remote place like Kunachi, this group has taken that innovation and then making it practically happening. I had an occasion to meet the patients also. They are also, some of them are at an advanced stage, but still they are all feeling comfortable now, saying it's getting cured. So friends, we, as I told you, we have challenges of poverty, challenge of unemployment, challenge of illiteracy, challenge of gender inequalities, discrimination here and there, infant mortality, maternal mortality, communicable and lifestyle diseases, and on the other front, we are also fighting terrorism, extremism, degradation of moral values in the society, and social evils like caste system and untouchability. According to the National Family Health Survey, 38.4% children in India are stunted and 21% wasted. We might not be able to find solution to all these pressing problems at once, but we can start, a start can be made. Innovations need to be groundbreaking. They need not cost billions of dollars and they need not be paradigm altering. There should be a simple covenant when it comes to innovation. It should contribute to making the lives of the people better. It should contribute towards alleviating suffering. It should be equally accessible, available, to useful to every section of the population. The last man in the row, the weakest, the most deprived and suppressed and oppressed people, they should get advantage. India has always been as the capital of frugal innovations. It is said that necessity is the mother of all inventions, and we in India know very well that necessity, once our thriving economy, which is born lion's share in world trade, was looted and plundered by centuries by outsiders. Now we are again standing up. We must come out of the colonial mindset. When people start using the words colonial, these things, I try to educate them and also caution them. Brought some of the changes in parliament, whoever raises to place something on the table, they say, sir, I beg to lay on the table. I told the ministers and others, here afterwards, no begging in parliament. You simply use the word, I raise. It's an independent India. Now the practice is on. Britishers, while going, they made all such practices. Every letter, sir, you are obediently. Why obedient? We are independent India. Sincerely, simple. That's also now going on. And even this good morning, good afternoon, good evening, why three times? Good morning, and then you know whether it is good afternoon or good night or bad night. Simple one thing, namaskara. Namaskara is our samskara. Morning, afternoon, evening, any time, namaskara. Simple things. And the children also, I am telling them, all the children I am telling here also, let us practice, propagate, speak and talk in our mother tongue. Five things are important. Five. Everyone should remember five things in life. One, the mother who has given you the beautiful life, the mother and father, you should never, never forget them. Should not create a situation where you put them in old age home and go once in a year and then wish them and say, oh, still you are alive. Thank you. You say, that is not our method. We must take care of our parents. For my liking for this group is one, preservation of the family system. Dharmanikyam, Balasubramanyam and Srinivasan all together, living together, working together, planning together, and the second generation also. All family is part of our Indian rich culture. Preserve the family system. Second, remember the Janma Bhumi, the place which has given you beautiful birth. Mahalingam has reached Chennai, became a legislator and became something, but still he never forgot his Janma Bhumi, Polachi. He came back and started all these institutions here because you have to pay back to society. That's a model for all of us to follow. Remember the birthplace, Janma Bhumi. Third, mother tongue, the language that has come from mother's womb, the Tamil, the great Tamil, that has to be spoken, that has to be. The Tamil, the Telugu, the Kannada, Malayali, Marathi, Punjabi, Assami, Bhojpuri, Dogri, Kashmiri, whatever language that has come to you from your mother, that should be spoken. We have different languages, 860 languages, 760 languages. Alag bhasha, alag vesh, phir bhi apna ek desh, vividhata mein ekata, Bharat ka visheshata. We are different languages, but we are all one. Irrespective of caste, creed, sex, religion, region, India is one. One nation, one people, one country. That feeling should be there. This mother tongue is very important. The mother tongue is very important because language and also culture go together. Bhasha aur bhavana ek saath chalta hai. The language and culture go together, move together. This has to be understood by one and all. That's why speak in your mother tongue. Mother tongue is like your eyesight. Mother tongue is like your eyesight. Other language is like spectacles. If you have eyesight, these spectacles can improve the foresight. If you don't have sight at all, then if you wear even Raban glass also, nothing will happen. So first, learn your mother tongue. There is a craze for English medium. I am not against English medium, but first study in Tamil medium. Then go to English. Learn as many languages as possible. I know I am in Tamil Nadu, I am telling you. Learn as many languages as possible. Every South Indian also should try to learn Hindi, and every North Indian should try to learn one South Indian language. That is the future. That will make our future comfortable. I can tell you, I am from Nellore, nearer to Chennai. I participated in anti-Hindi agitation. Later on, I went to Delhi. In the party, the National General Secretary, then I realized my handicap. Picked up Hindi. Then today, in between, I could become the National President. IAS, IPS, National Services, it requires knowledge of more than mother tongue. So mother tongue, other language. Then learn English also. I am not against English. English, I am only against English mind. British mind. They gave history. Robert Clive the Great, Victoria the Great. People who came and ruled us and ruined us, they are great. Not our great people like Veerapandiya Kattabomman. Why his name is not there in the history? Why enough importance is not given? Why Pasuppan Muthuramalinga Thevar? Why his name is not being given importance? Why V.O. Chidambaram Pillai? Why Subramanya Bharati? Why Satyamurthy? Why Rajagopalachari? Why great Kamaraj? Why they were all not given enough importance? You have Narayana Guru. You have Adi Shankara. You have Andhra Pradesh, Alluri Sitaramaraju, a lot of people from every region. British have suppressed all these histories. They glorified themselves because they are ruled. Recently, I have been to Latin America. In Peru, in Panama, and in Guatemala, nobody remembers their ancient mother tongue. Because the Spanish people came, Spanish came, and their local language vanished from their state. So that danger is there. Learn English. Be proficient, no problem at all. Should learn also English also. But should not forget Tamil, our mother tongue. I will tell you an interesting thing because you are all students and all educated people are here. There is no scope for misunderstanding. Recently when I started promoting this, some people said, Mr. Naidu said, English is illness. I never said. English mind is the illness. Point is, French president came recently. Iranian president came recently. He did PhD in English in London. I thought he will speak in English. He did not speak in English. He spoke in his language and there was a translator sitting next to him, translating to Narendra Bhai Modi. Russian president, Putin. Chinese president. Armenian president. Belarus president. Any number of readers are coming. They are all speaking in their respective mother tongue and translation. Taking time. I asked Sushma Swaraj, External Affairs Minister, "Kya Sushmaji, they do not know English?" He said, many of them know. But they will never speak in other language. They will speak in their mother tongue only. That is their principle. We Indians, whether we know it or not, we try to speak that in that language, not in our language. This is the problem. This is what I am trying to say. And some people say, sir, if you don't go to convent, then you will not go up. Going up, God has not prescribed any language. Everybody will go up without language. That date and place is decided already. It is not in your hands. No, then somebody said, sir, not going up means going to higher level. Dr. Kalam studied in ordinary school. Narendra Bhai Modi studied in ordinary school. Venkaiah Naidu never went to convent but could occupy second highest constitutional position in the country. Edappadi Palaniswamy, I think he has not gone to convent. Our Velumani also might not have gone to convent. Chandrababu Naidu, I asked him, he never went to convent. Chandrasekhar Rao, I asked him, Telangana, he never went to convent. Many, but still they came up. So question is, you must have character, caliber, capacity and conduct. You must have discipline, dynamism, dedication and devotion. Come up, you will come up. Abdul Kalam said, aim high and dream high. Dream, a polytechnic student, sometime may become president of India, we don't know. Or the chief minister of Tamil Nadu, we don't know. If you work hard, look at the background of all these great people. Even Rajinikanth, what was he earlier? The great star. So it's hard work. It is proficiency. It is efficiency. And also, if you have commitment, you can really come up. I am born in an agriculture family. Ordinary agriculture family. We had good amount of land, but it was all. Agriculture income is comparatively less now. My father, mother, they never went to school beyond 10th class. Grandfather was not. Nobody was in politics. But still, I used to walk 3 kilometers a day, go to school. In my school, both the Surya and Chandra, moon and sun, they used to live together. One in the morning, another in the night. So there was no proper roof also. And in between, Varuna, also, rain god also used to visit. Because it's open. From that situation to this situation, two things have made me to come here. One is the hard work, second is consistency. Same ideology without change. So my friends, what I am trying to suggest to you is youngsters, work hard. Be disciplined. Discipline not for the principal, not for the correspondent, not because of headmaster, because of your own future. And have developed social consciousness. We must live for the society, socially conscious. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. Sharing and caring for others. That should be our attitude. And then we must also be friendly with the nature. Love and live with the nature. Love and live with the nature. Nature, culture together for a better future. That's my advice to all of you. So preserve the nature. Be friendly with the greenery. Plant as many trees as possible and protect them. Second, expose to the sun. Not to your sun, but sun. So we are really fortunate, so much light. Then I was in London, the driver told me, "Sir, good morning." I said, "Okay, namaste." Then he said, "Sir, today is sunny day, very happy day." I said, "Is it your son's birthday?" He said, "No, sir." I said, "Then what sunny day?" He said, "Sir, sun is bright, sir, today." Then I told him, "Poor fellow, India 365 days are sunny days. Every day sun is bright." But we never took advantage. But today, India is moving, took lead for solar alliance. 175 gigawatts of solar is our target. 175 gigawatts. Solar has to be harnessed. Rainwater harvesting, that should be our practice. Every house must have a rainwater harvesting pit. Our planners, country planners, urban planners must make it mandatory. And then third one is with the nature of preserving water. We have seen the havoc caused to Chennai because of encroachments of the rivers, rivulets. You might have read yesterday in a business line newspaper. I suggest to you, some of the youngsters and others, read it yesterday. After Kerala floods, you may not believe the story, even I didn't believe initially. After floods, within 1 month, a study was done. The groundwater level in those affected areas has gone down considerably. What is happening? Even southern Karnataka, coastal Karnataka, that Kudugu area, which was affected, devastated, there also the groundwater levels have gone down. Chennai, when I came here after the floods, everyone told me, "Sir, everything, every lake is encroached. There's no way That's why, friend, sudden water has come. We must learn lessons from this. Stop the encroachments. Preserve the water. The rivulets, the rivers. Rivers are goddesses to us. We should protect the rivers and protect the water. This water, this light, this nature, trees, all things are very important for a healthy life. You may have wealthy life. Wealthy life doesn't assure you healthy life. Even if you have wealthy, so much money, you can't eat a Coimbatore Krishna sweets if you are sugar diabetic. Or you cannot go to Annapurna restaurant and have sumptuous food. So healthy, health is important more than wealth. If health is there, wealth automatically will come. If wealth is there, no guarantee health will come. So my youngsters, please keep this in mind. Swachha Bharat or yoga. Yoga is for your body and mind. Yoga is not for Modi. This is for your body. You must understand this. It brings union of mind and body, synergy, exercise for your own benefit, being smart, being healthy, you can come up in life. This has to be understood. And then if you see, people see you being smart. The other day, there was an award distribution function. I had an occasion to meet Pullela Gopichand, the badminton star. I know him for a lot of you. Every year he is becoming more slim. More slim and more attractive. And because you get confidence, no? If the person is perfectly maintaining his body, then naturally it will influence your mind. You will be present. If your mind is present, you will do present things. Yesterday, Sadhguru Vasudevji also seems to have said the same thing on the same lines. So please take care of it. And my advice to all of you is India has always been known as the capital of frugal innovations. It is said that necessity is the mother of all inventions, and there is necessity now because we have to move faster. From Jaipur foot, invented by Dr. Sethi, who made it possible for the poorest of the poor to afford prosthesis, to Padma Sri Arunachalam Muruganandam, who hails from this very city, Coimbatore, and invested his life savings to manufacture affordable sanitary napkins for women's safety. So solely because of his concern for menstrual hygiene, India is teeming with innovative brilliance, from water wheels to bicycles fitted with dynamos to tree climbing machines. India, especially rural India, has showcased its resilience, spirit of surveillance to the world, survival. You, as the future technocrats of the world, must learn from these innovators and explore the possibility of adopting and scaling these innovations so that they can help a much larger number of people. No technology, however, state of the art and futuristic, will stand the test of time if it does not contribute tangibly to improve lives. The purpose of science and technology is to make life of the people comfortable. Keep that in mind. Innovation should also keep in mind the status of our environment. We have to understand that climate change is real. These imbalances in nature and scales have tipped to a point that nature is forced to react, and react fiercely and violently. A recent study done by Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology, Pune, highlighted that number of extreme rainfall events have gone up by threefold in India. According to study, there have been 285 reported flooding events in India over 1950 to 2017, affecting about 850 million people, leaving 19 million homeless and killing about 71,000 people. Kerala is an example. Chennai is an example. Hudhud is an example. There are so many examples, I don't want to take your time. Some of the most celebrated scientists in the world history have also been women. We must encourage women, women's education. India has a rich tradition of women participate in all walks of life, from science to philosophy to politics to the art of warfare. Yet somewhere along the road, we fail to promote women in science and technology. No nation can make progress if women lag behind. With women constituting about 50% of the country's population, every effort has to be made to empower them economically, politically, and every other field. With programs like Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, government has taken initiative, but it's not the government's job alone. We should all. Swami Vivekananda said, I quote, "There is no chance for the welfare of the world unless the condition of women is improved. It is impossible for a bird to fly on one wing. When our innovations take flight, it should be using both wings. The flight should be powerful, steadying, focused, and relentless. I hope that you have enough girl students here in this institution. It's a very happy moment. Only girls are clapping, boys are keeping silent. To clap, you need both hands. To have children, you need both people. To fly, you need both wings. So to live together, you need both men and women to come up in life. This has to be understood by all. Friends, we have good business skills. Coimbatore is a good example. We have vocational skills. We have so many other things with us. We should utilize them properly. And we should be constructive in our mind, not obstructive or destructive. Parliament, Panchayat, Municipality, Assembly, everywhere, discuss, debate and decide. Do not disrupt. Let the government propose. Let the opposition wishes oppose. Let the government propose. Let the opposition oppose. Let the House dispose. Parliament dispose. That should be the attitude. We must be tolerant to the other man's view or other woman's view. Be tolerant to other man's view. And before that, be tolerant to the mandate of the people. People have given a mandate, whichever party it is. You have to respect the mandate and try for your luck next time. That is the order of the day. So I am very happy today. This institution with 12,000 students and thousands of employees offering education from kindergarten to research in 4 campuses inside Polachi is really very inspiring. I wish the institution good luck, and I am sure the glory of this institution will soar higher and higher. May you lead the way to the creation of the resurgent and also resplendent India. Thank you very much. Nandri, Vanakkam.